Dr. Satrio Sumantri Brojonegoro is the president of the Indonesian Academy of Sciences, and he is joining us here now in Los Angeles to talk about the impact of the climate crisis on Indonesia. Welcome, Dr. Satrio. Thank you so much for traveling all the way from Jakarta to be with us here today.
With pleasure. Thank you.
So, Dr. Satrio, Indonesia is known for its beautiful beaches, but with that expansive coastline, it is also considered one of the most at-risk countries when it comes to the climate crisis. Can you tell us a bit about what you're experiencing in terms of impacts and how those impacts are affecting the health of your citizens?
Yeah, as Indonesia has more than 17,000 islands, therefore 60% of the population live in the coastal areas. So any change or any influence to the coastal area, for example, climate change, it will create some coastal ecosystem degradation, including water availability also decrease, and changes in the crop production, as well as the loss of biodiversity. Climate change has also an impact on health, mortality, food security, migration pattern, natural ecosystem, and economic prosperity, both at local and national level. Climate change also will impact Indonesian condition. For example, the average temperature now in Indonesia, temperature rise, is between 0.5 to 3.92 centigrade in 2100, using the data we obtained from 1981 to 2010. As for rainfall, for example, we have a dry season and rainy season. Now it's shift. You know, we can no longer predict when we'll have rain and when we have a dry season. So the farmer will be very severely influenced for that. In 2050, the sea level rise due to global warming is projected to be 35 to 40 centimeters relative to the year 2000. But that is the prediction without the dynamic ice melting. If we include that, it can be much higher than that. Perhaps it can reach to 175 centimeters in 2100. In Indonesia also, cases of malaria, dengue, diarrhea, cholera are predicted to increase with temperature rise. As you know, when temperature rise, the bacteria will develop even faster. And also because our water become contaminated, affecting the poor people who live in the coastal area, and there are nothing they can do for coping the condition. Water scarcity is an additional issue as a result of climate change. Illness stemming from vehicular emissions and air pollution include acute respiratory infection, bronchial asthma, bronchitis, and eye and skin irritation. Among other impact of climate change, the impact of human health has unique pathways transmission and is specific for every single disease. Once unique pathway transmission occurs, the spreading of disease will continue from one infected people to other, and from the new infected people to broader population due to the snowballing effect.
Well, we've been talking about how this climate crisis is becoming a health crisis. Yeah. And it's true that Indonesia is really at the front lines of all of this. And this is why you are a strong advocate of blue carbon policies to be implemented in your country. First of all, can you begin by telling us what blue carbon is?
Yeah.
And how will these policies and initiatives help create a positive impact on the climate crisis?
Yeah, blue carbon concept is a concept that carbon is captured by the world oceans and coastal ecosystem via photosynthesis and then stored in the form of biomass and sediment in mangroves, seagrass, and phytoplankton. Principally, ecosystem sequester and store significant amount of coastal blue carbon from the atmosphere and ocean, and hence are now recognized as their role in mitigating climate change. So when we have can capture the carbon, then we can control the climate change. That's the idea. Since 1990s, Indonesian government has grown more aware of conserving and developing the blue carbon ecosystem. In fact, in 1999, the Ministry of Marine Affairs and Fisheries was established with the aim to improve coastal community welfare and maintain the environmental condition of all marine areas and resources. The coordinating ministry for maritime affairs was later on established to coordinate and ensure the implementation of maritime policies and regulation. The formation of both ministry is crucial to Indonesia conservation effort for its blue carbon, as both agency release a number of critical regulation and policies. Although we have initiated and participated in many international conservation events and conduct scientific research through international collaboration, including producing the National Science Plan on Blue Carbon for 2015-2020. But still, we have some challenges to overcome.
So these coastal ecosystems, they are absolutely pivotal and critical when it comes to carbon sequestration, as well as biodiversity and blue carbon. You talked about how the government is moving towards conservation of coastal ecosystems, but what is the level of public awareness when it comes to conserving these coastal ecosystems?
With Indonesia's strategic maritime position and its rich resources, conservation work is now more important than ever. Conservation here does not mean simply only to preserve and protect the existing ecosystem, but it also means developing said area to improve and surrounding community in social economic situation, because we don't want people to just having the conservation without additional value for the economic growth. Otherwise, people will complain and say, oh, better we just scrap the mangrove and build the infrastructure or fish pond or something. So conservation efforts must be in line with the growth of employment opportunity in this location. The awareness level varies. Some area, they're aware that it's important to preserve the ecosystem, while in other area, they feel they have better opportunity if they convert into fish pond, infrastructure, and perhaps a port or housing. One of the biggest challenges in implementing conservation effort is in changing people's behavior or mindset by educating and creating awareness of the importance of preserving the area ecosystem from both an economic and environmental standpoint. Therefore, many destroy their surrounding natural environment for short-term goal, despite potentially losing the area resources in the long term.
Changing behavior is really a long-term process.
Mindset change.
Although it needs to be something that happens in the short term.
They have to.
So let's talk specifically about the mangroves, because I know it's you have a lot of mangroves in Indonesia. And how does the loss of the mangrove ecosystem affect the climate crisis?
Mangrove ecosystem seems to be small compared to the overall area of the coastal line. But it's the most productive system or ecosystem, even compared with other ocean ecosystems. Research show that beach vegetation could absorb much higher level of atmospheric carbon dioxide than land vegetation. So we focus on how to use this beach vegetation to absorb more carbon. Out of all various beach plants, the mangroves ecosystem has the capability to absorb the highest level of carbon dioxide in comparison to tropical rainforest, salt marsh, and seagrass meadows. Further than that, mangrove forest absorb CO2 and store it as organic carbon in biomass and sediments. Therefore, losing mangrove ecosystem contribute severely to the climate crisis. And maybe I should add now, what measures have been taken in Indonesia to restore its mangroves? Indonesia early conservation effort include rehabilitating a beach area through a reclamation and rejuvenation of local mangrove forest by creating ecotourism. So we create an area, the mangrove forest, to become an ecotourism area. Unfortunately, many of these projects have faced technical and political hurdles. Hence, they have not produced the most optimal result yet. In fact, Indonesia has initiated the ecotourism since 2010. It's quite a significant move by itself. Furthermore, government regulation and participation towards conserving mangrove ecosystem have positively impacted the local community's preservation effort too. For example, through effective public and private partnership, they have rehabilitated 2 to 4 million mangroves in North Java, West Sumatra, and South Sulawesi. This partnership have also attempted to introduce other benefit to creating sustainable mangrove ecosystem by developing the honeybee industry in mangrove forest, creating food products from mangroves and ecotourism.
So there's lots of opportunity to mitigate the climate crisis through the mangrove ecosystem and as well as blue carbon. Let's go back to blue carbon. Can you tell us how blue carbon initiatives should be factored in to the emission cuts when it comes to countries and their promises for the Paris Agreement?
As mentioned earlier, the coastal ecosystem sequester and store significant amount of coastal blue carbon from the atmosphere and ocean, and hence become the main role in mitigating climate change. So when they absorb significant carbon, they will do the role on that. Indonesia commitment on the 2015 Paris Climate Change Agreements is outlined in nationally determined contribution that describe the country's transition to a low carbon and climate resilience future as follows. And blue carbon is an important part of that section. Unconditionally reduce emission to 26% below business as usual by 2020 and 29% by 2030. The conditional reduction, an additional 12%, is subject to provision in the global agreement, including through bilateral cooperation, covering technology development and transfer, capacity building, payment for performance mechanisms, technical cooperation, and access to financial resources. Sources of reduction include energy, industry, agriculture, land use change and forestry, and waste. Reduced risk in all development sectors by 2030 through local capacity strengthening, improved knowledge management, convergent policy on climate change adaptation and disaster risk reduction, and application of adaptive technology.
Well, Dr. Satrio, I would like to thank you very much for your leadership in this issue and also for traveling all the way from Jakarta to join us here on 24 Hours of Reality. Thank you.
You're welcome.